Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome back to another Join Dota live stream. Once again, we're going to be covering the I-League qualifier. This time around, we got Dream Team going up against Sick Arrow. I'm not sure who Sick Arrow is. I actually do recognize a couple of the names, as you should as well. Nubik especially, Seam of the Slayer, is also, I think, a... I think I've seen him stand in every once in a while. So you should recognize a couple different names. It looks like they've actually got three stand-ins according to the tags they are currently rocking. But yeah, this is the I-League US European qualifier. And this is the round of 64, meaning we are going to have some teams that you may not recognize. Dream Team, obviously the more well-known team going into this game. And we already have some... pretty standard pickups. Okay, so the Shadow Demon Mirana is a 1-2 combo that hasn't been seen as much lately. More likely, people are trying to grab Doom as soon as possible, get a Skywrath Mage in their pool, Faces Void, Razor, Viper, those kind of heroes. But a Shadow Demon Mirana combo is going to go the way of Dream Team. Well, a different kind of combo is going to be picked up by Sick Arrow. They go for the Skywrath Mage and Faceless Void. So... the classic ultimates that we've seen time and time again. I didn't think there was ever... I don't think there was ever going to be a time where I was going to be sick of seeing a Skywrath Mage pickup. But it's beginning to get there. Just slightly. I mean, I love me some Skywrath Mage. But good God, this guy is being picked up left, right, and center. We have Doom, Earthshaker, Furion, and Tidehunter all being banned away by Sick Arrow, Brewmaster, Razor, Invoker. And now waiting on the last ban for a Dream Team. Presumably would be an Ancient Apparition. Ancient Apparition, Faces Void, one of the strongest support carry combos in the game when it comes to mid-game ultimates. But at the same time, Ancient Apparition can sometimes leave yourself exposed to the early game because Ancient Apparition, while can be a strong laner with his Chilling Touch at level 1, will fall off as you start getting into level 3 to 5, I would say. And especially has a massive defect in the fact that he properly move around the map at all. Right, he has no, like, unless you have some sort of, like, two different setup stuns for Cold Feet, in which case Ancient Apparition is not giving you the kill there. It's everyone else who's setting up the kill. So Ancient Apparition is pretty weak when it comes to roaming early on, and that could leave him a little bit exposed. The Skywrath Mage, though, is definitely, I think, one of the strongest supports in the pool right now. Massive amounts of damage. His one big downside is that he doesn't have a stun. Right, so it allows certain like really mobile heroes to sometimes be able to get away before the silence is in range or something like that. That is the one big downside for a Skywrath Mage, but everything else he is so strong at. He outputs a ton of damage early on in harassing. His roaming is not bad at all because you don't actually necessarily have to rely on smoke or getting close enough in range because that W is such long range, you'll always be able to get it off. Death Prophet was the last ban from Dream Team, so apparently feeling a little bit more of a push strat from Sick Arrow. Plus, Death Prophet is really strong with Faceless Void. Anything that can hold heroes immobile for long periods of time, Death Prophet is going to be cashing in on that time and outputting massive amounts of physical damage. The biggest downside of the Death Prophet ultimate is really the fact that it's very, very easy to kite the ghost and limit the amount of damage done. So if you're running away from the Death Prophet, your amount of damage that you do is completely different than the amount of damage to somebody that's running at the Death Prophet or even somebody who's just standing still. Because the closer proximity you are with a Death Prophet to the target that the ghosts are trying to latch onto, the more damage you do. Because every Death Prophet ghost has to run at the target, hit the target, come back to Death Prophet before it goes out again. They're like... not quite as simple as that, but basic rundown of the ability. So it actually makes a lot more sense. If you can hold heroes in place, you'll do a lot more damage with that exorcism. And of course, Chronosphere being just a great zoning ability as well, allowing the Death Prophet to sit in the back and not worry about taking a whole lot of aggro. Clockwork now being grabbed by Dream Team 168, so you have another hero who's going to be setting up some Mirana arrows, though I'm kind of feeling this is going to be a support Mirana here. It's entirely possible that we see a 1 or even 2 position Mirana, but with this setup right now, I think Dream Team are probably angling themselves to either pick up a pusher or a harder carry than Mirana. One way or the other, though, I do not think...
Radiant team pick.
Oh, my bad. Apologies, guys. I did say earlier that we were going to be covering Team Tinker today, but apparently that was wrong. I must have misread the schedule. That is going to be tomorrow, so that is my fault. I apologize to everyone out there who is coming here to see Team Tinker.
10 seconds remaining.
I totally misread the schedule.
Enigma.
Dire team
Viper
pick.
Gonna be grabbed now by Sick Arrow. What a surprise, man. And we are not gonna be seeing a Mirana support. I figured that's what we were going for. Dream team taking it back a little bit, but now they grab the Enigma, which should be the four position. So we now have a Mirana 1. Now we're left with is a mid for Dream Team 168. And they do. I'm kind of feeling some sort of pusher here, but we'll have to see. You definitely don't want to be going late game up against a Faceless Void.
Remaining.
Sick Arrow have a really nice team fight composition going into the mid game, though.
Five
between
seconds
the
remaining.
Chronosphere setup into the Skywrath Mage Ultimate, you kind of guarantee yourself
Reserve
one,
time.
Possibly even two kills within that Chronosphere time. Then you have the massive amount of sustain offered to you by a Viper, who is so naturally tanky anyway, but also is going to be picking up an early mech. So their mid-game is going to be really tough to deal with. Dream Team definitely do have a strong fighting lineup, but the Enigma is the only one downside. Shattered Demon, Mirana, Clockwork all fight very, very early. Enigma will take a little bit extra time to be able to farm up the mech. Possibly will need the Blink Dagger or even BKB before you're a stronger
Radiant
impact in these team
ban.
Fights. Tree and Protector now being grabbed, though, by Sick Arrow, and that is a very
Dire
sick support
ban.
Combination. It's double slows early on, plus a massive amount of damage. I mean, Leech Seed plus the right clicks of Tree and Protector. You add an additional slow. Tree and Protector is probably going to be doing 200 to 300 damage just through right clicks alone when you go
Ten
on one hero.
Remaining.
And then you add in the large amount of magic damage from the Skywrath Mage Nukes consistently
Five
flying
remaining.
Out. Dream Team are actually going to be banning away the Vengeful Spirit here.
Reserve time.
Which is rather odd. Maybe they've faced this combination up before, because that would mean if Vengeful Spirit was picked up here for Sick Arrow,
remaining.
I think that would mean Vengeful Spirit would be the one position. They would be running an aggro try,
Radiant team pick.
Leaving Faces Void as a safe lane and Viper as the mid. But that's definitely a very interesting ban. Not something that I expected out of Sick Arrow at all. I do expect them just to be grabbing an offlaner here. I didn't really consider the possibility of an aggro tribe, but again, their support combination is super strong, so it's a distinct possibility here. Kunkka's the last
remaining.
Ban out for Sick Arrow, which makes a lot of sense with all this wombo
Five
combo team fight.
Remaining.
You have the Clockwork who guarantees Arrow, but the Cogs will also set up easy torrents. Same goes with the Shatter Demon.
Reserve time. 5 seconds
and then
Kunkka
will also give a large amount of survivability to his whole entire team. But Venomancer is going to be the last pick up here
Dire
for Dream
Team
168.
Pick.
And sure enough, that is going to be a Mirana as a 1, Venomancer as a 2 position in the mid lane, I believe. He's going to be going up against the Viper. I'm not too sure how this matchup goes, though. I'm not convinced that it favors the Venomancer. Obviously, at level 5, once you have... I'm presuming we're going to be seeing a 1-1-4 build for the Venomancer, and he's going to be maxing out wards. Once you hit level 5 and you just start spamming out wards, it should be, you know, an easy lane for Venomancer. Before then, though, I don't think the harassment abilities of Venomancer outdo the Viper, because Venomancer has a lower range than Viper. And even if you do harass the Viper, if he goes Corrosive Skin, you're taking just as much damage back. So, I'm not sure how this is going to work. Dream Team, maybe they have some opportunities to change up the lanes even further, but I think that would be the default lane that I would go for. Windranger going to be the last pickup here for Sick Arrow. And, works well with the Faces Void. If you get a good Chronosphere, there's a chance you could probably hit a pretty good Shackle off the back of that. But also, the Chronosphere will set you up with a good amount of time where you can lay down some Focus Fire from Windranger, which... It's not an ability you normally talk about for a Windranger unless you're seeing a, like, two-position Windranger or even a one-position. But here, I think, with the amount of disable between the Overgrowth and Faceless Void's Chronosphere, you could actually do a damn decent amount of damage with that Windranger ult.
10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
So, all around, looking at this... I feel that Sick Arrow actually have the better lineup here, just because they have such great combination with the Faceless Void in so many ways. They have a Train Protector to make everybody tankier, right? They're already going to have an early mech advantage over Dream Team, depending on how well the Enigma farms. Like, Enigma is probably going to be going straight for that mech, but there's a chance that Viper will actually pick up the mech before him, and they could actually try and force some fights. But between the mech as well as the Train Protector living armor, Faceless Void is going to be super tanky. And the same applies to Windranger, who obviously has that defensive Windrun ability as well to fall back on. So I think all in all, Sick Arrow actually have the stronger lineup here, and Dream Team are very much on the clock. Because the problem I see is that Dream Team do not have nearly as much late game potential as Sick Arrow does, and yet at the same time, I don't think they have such an overwhelming amount of mid-game teamfight. They definitely have enough where they're going to be able to force fights, and longer drawn-out fights should go their way with the Venomancer ultimate kicking into play. But at the same time, I think Sick Arrow just need to play off of their pickoff potential, right? If they just go in, they five-man, make the jump, get the Chronosphere, find the pickoff, and then go for a tower, or even back away after that. If they don't feel safe enough to force the fight with a one-hero advantage, then just back off and go back to farming. I mean, they have a Faceless Void for the late game, so I see no issues for them whatsoever past the 40, 45-minute mark. And looks like we're waiting on our last one. Windranger, finally. Nubik. Finally picks his hero, and we should be underway now. We'll go ahead and cover who's playing what since we have an unknown team. Might as well talk about who's playing what on that side. So on Sick Arrow, we have Seam of the Slayer is going to be playing the Faceless Void 1 position. No Fear is on the Skywrath Mage. We have, I guess you can call him Thundershock with a V. Not sure how to say that name. He's obviously advertising his Twitch account, but Thundershock is going to be on the Viper. Arzeek is going to be on the Train Protector, and that leaves Nubik for the Windranger. On the side of Dream Team, we have Afterlife going to be playing the offlane Clockwork. Wek is on the Shatter Demon, PGG on the Enigma. Scandal is going to be playing the Mirana, and ZXC on the Venomancer. Starting out the lanes, it looks like we are going to be seeing an aggro try Windranger for Sick Arrow. Skywrath Mage, Windranger, and Tree Protector. That is a very, very good aggro try. You've got a Tree Protector who's a good frontline hero. So at any point in time, if you get too close to the creep wave, you're going to be gone on by Leech Seed, slowed down by the Skywrath Mage concussive shot, and just simply right-click down. Maybe a power shot is thrown over the top, but this is a very dangerous combination. If I would Dream Team, if they're able to scout this out, I would try and dodge and go with the Clockwork. It's hard to say because the Clockwork is going to be, he's going to have a hard time against the dual range of Skywrath Mage as well as Windranger. But I do not think you want to fight this combination. I believe that they should be trying to run the Mirana Shadow Demon at the top lane, a top dual lane, with Enigma in the enemy jungle, ZXC in the mid, and Clockwork at bottom lane. And they just have to play super passive in the bottom lane and also be aware of rotations into mid. And of course, what better way to start out the day than a solo cast with a really long pause in the beginning of the game? It's literally the best way to start. Thundershock has been fed a ton of tangos, by the way. Three different tangos, and is probably, I would presume, going to be going for the Wraithband, which is a pretty standard start for the Viper. They fed him the extra bit of regen because he's going to be going up against a Venomancer, and they don't want him to be out-harassed. You can see Venomancer going for a very similar build, Wraithband into Tango. I expect him to go for a fast ring of Akilla, go for treads, and probably try and push down some towers very early on. Like, again, Dreamtime definitely on the clock. Need to be able to end this game as soon as possible. Just because a Mirana is a very glass cannon-ish carry. I mean, she's stronger than Many others, like Draw Ranger and Sniper, are by far like some of the squishiest carries out there. Even when comparing to Luna, I believe Mirana has slightly more survivability because she has her own escape mechanism with Leap, as well as, I suppose, you could throw the Moonlight Shadow in there as well. So Mirana is a bit tankier than some of the other Glass Cannon carries you can list, but she's still very susceptible to just being held in place and right-click down, and that's exactly what the Chronosphere is going to do. Faces Void is, I think, the ultimate counter to Glass Cannon carries. Any heroes, Luna, if you run a Drow Ranger, anything like that, Faces Void is just able to... I mean, he's such strong initiation. And he's so naturally tanky that he can actually take a little bit of aggro from some of those heroes without immediately faltering. So I'm concerned. Like, normally Mirana, you go, okay, late game potential is eh. You know, it's solidly meh. If you get a bunch of farm, sure, you can absolutely carry. But you have no inherent carry abilities from Mirana. She's an agility hero, and that's pretty much it. Like, your nukes will start falling off eventually. Arrow is still really strong going into late game because of the large stun duration, if you can land it. The escape mechanisms are nice, but nothing actually increases the damage that you're really outputting all that much. So when it comes to true carry potential, Mirana is fairly middling in the list. You're mainly playing around gold, and that's why you need to be able to get an advantage early. And if they go late, I don't think, even if the Mirana is fed, going up against a Faceless Void with any decent amount of farm should be able to take you out every single time. The one big advantage they have, though, is while Chronosphere is excellent initiation, that is pretty much it for the initiation of Sick Arrow. So Dream Team, on the other side, they have the Mirana Arrow, they have Moonlight Shadow, they've got Clockwork jumping in with Hookshot, as well as the Enigma Black Hole over the top. What's so good about this is the fact that they have so many good initiating tools on several different heroes that they can actually constantly force fights, whereas Sick Arrow, they're looking for one fight every 2 minutes. Dream Team are like, every 30 seconds, let's go for another pickoff, let's go for another pickoff, let's Moonlight Shadow this time, let's go for the Clockwork Hook and land an arrow off of it. You know, every 30 to 45 seconds, they should be finding some sort of pickoff with one of their abilities. Whereas the Faces Void, it's like all about the Chronosphere and no one else can really provide that same sort of initiation. It's unlikely you get, you know, clutch shackle shots leading. I mean, it happens in games like this, but at the same time, it's not a reliable initiating tool. Most teams should be able to play it around it very well. Viper is very obvious when he goes to initiate, right? It's just you get a range of Viper strike, so that you should have all the heads up in the world. Skywrath Mage is decent in that regard, but it's just a single target slow, so it's really only strong initiation in the early game. And then you have the Terrain Protector, who has a chance of being able to have a good initiation with Nature's Guise and Overgrowth. But again, I'm listing all these things that feel like they're very, very situational and maybe only strong in the early game. Looks like we may finally be ready. Oh, I didn't notice. We are going to be having a PGG Enigma, by the way. The legend himself. Picking up the Enigma. So aggro try versus, we'll have to see. We'll have to see how Dream Team react to this. And I'm surprised ZXC's just coming with the team. Weck is a little bit farther behind, but they probably just want to be able to establish some dominance in their jungle, make sure that nothing is blocked out, but also see what the situation is going to be in this bottom lane, because I do not think they should try and run the Shadow Demon Mirana with the Enigma in the jungle. Now, Shadow Demon Mirana is a very successful duel lane because it's the right mix of both offensive and defensive abilities. Mirana has an escape mechanism, and she's in real big trouble. You always have a disruption to be able to save her a couple of seconds. So it can be run very defensive and then just wait for that one pickoff. My main concern would be the Enigma is going to be shut down if you try and run him in his own jungle, because the aggro try is having a hard time getting kills up against the Shadow Demon Mirana combo. They're going to rotate heavily into the jungle, and I think the Enigma is going to have a super hard time in that regard. But it looks like they're going to go for it anyway. PGG is going to start out by denying one creep in the middle lane before heading back and farming up these camps. No blocks just yet. We do have finally one ward being placed by the Shadow Demon, which is going to block out this pull camp. So there's going to be no double pull available, but I think they should have put more effort into establishing wards to block out this hard camp right here. Because Enigma, if necessary, can just bounce between these two camps and just still get a good amount of farm. So I think that was a slight mistake by Sick Arrow, but at the same time, Marauders should be shut down pretty heavily here when it comes to CS, even if they can't get the kill. They'll just be able to harass her out of lane and make sure she doesn't come forward too much. Clockwork versus the Faceless Void is not a bad matchup one way or the other. Faceless Void is tanky enough to be able to deal with the Clockwork. At the same time, Clockwork has the opportunity to harass the Faceless Void by quite a bit. There goes your first disruption arrow combination onto No Fear. Brings him down to about half health, but obviously against this aggro try, there's no way they're going to be able to actually get a kill early on. That was just to get a little harassment in against the enemy supports and make sure that they don't feel safe just running forward and constantly harassing like that. Mintra C, yep, there it is. Viper trying to zone out ZXE very early on. ZXE taking a large amount of damage from these right clicks again. Thunderstock, well, he didn't actually go for the Corrosive Skin. I'm surprised he didn't go for that at level 2, considering the fact that he's dealing with a Venomancer who you know is going to be trying to lay down some right clicks as much as possible.
Close.
But sure enough, still picks up the 1-1-1. You can already see ZXC's plan, though. By level 3, he's already spammed out a whole bunch of Plague Wards. And that is going to be his mainstay. And this is the best way to run up against Viper. I would say the best heroes to go up against a Viper or Razor or any heroes that have spamming abilities. So whether that's like Death Prophet and you just Crypt Swarm the wave every single time it comes close, or in this case, Venomancer, who just spams out wards everywhere, and the Viper is not going to be able to go forward into those wards to harass and chase down Venomancer. Illusions will certainly help, though, to be able to zone him out. I feel overall, though, Dream Team are getting the better side of this laning phase solely because of the fact that PGG is free farming the jungle. And that gives me a lot of concern. I feel like this Sick Arrow aggro try could have been run a lot better if they just blocked out the wards, but it also seems like they're not doing too great a job of finding any kills against this dual lane. Again, it's tough, but actually, I say that. I was looking at the wrong CS. Scandal has only had one CS, so they're doing fine, actually. They're picking up a full amount of experience, but our Zeke, he's doing something cheeky, but it's not going to be that strong. He is just trying to soak up some of the experience the Enigma is farming in the jungle, but this is something that is not going to be a game-winning situation at all. Like, the Enigma is still going to be picking up a lot of farm. That's still going to be a very fast mech for this Enigma. And that concerns me because I felt like the Viper was going to be the biggest advantage for Sick Arrow going into the mid-game. Scandal making a quick leap away as the Tree Protector reveals his rotation into the lane once again. 20-9 on the Windranger, topping out the board, but at the same time, both Enigma and Clockwork are not far behind with 18-2 and 16-5. I'm happy to see Afterlife is doing so well in CS. I think a lot of Clockworks were focused overly on trying to harass another melee hero like Faceless Void, but I just simply don't think it's worth the trade-off here. Faceless Void is a very dangerous right clicker. I think you should just do what he's doing right now, which is burn him out with cogs, force him away from some CS, and just focus on getting your level 6 as soon as possible, and start making that first rotation. As soon as he hits level 6, he should be going to this bottom lane and threatening the aggro try, because they're all massively underleveled due to the fact they're all sharing the same amount of experience here. So they're all going to be level 4 by the time you're level 6. You can see Afterlife, he went for quite the melee-focused build here, which is the maxed-out battery assault, which gives you a lot more kill potential, but also the second level in cogs as well, which you normally, if it, kill potential comes from battery assault, I feel, most heavily. But you usually go for a 3-1-1 build. The only time you level up cogs an extra level, I think, is if you're going up against melees and you really want to burn away their mana as much as possible. Zima. He's doing the smartest Radiant's thing he can, though, which is fighting face, fighting the clockwork underneath the creep wave. So he makes sure the battery salt is going to be, a lot of the damage is going to be soaked up by the creep wave. And he just turns and right clicks. And with a maxed out time lock, he out DPSs the clockwork. As long as the battery assault is not. Zima has to be careful here. If Afterlife is actually able to successfully force him away, he still has a hookshot as well to be able to lay down. But every single time, Zima just hugs the creeps and is safe because of it. Arrow's gonna come out. Nice dodge there from RZQQ. Gets himself away, and they're actually going to try and go for the kill here. Scandal silenced up, and they can try and burst him out. Nice dodge, and now the black hole on three heroes. Arzeke is going to go down. The Starlight is going to go over the top as well, as No Fear is going to be the second death, presumably, as a Shadow Poison. Yep, there goes. Double kill for Weck. That was a completely, and again, it makes the big difference if you do not shut down the Enigma by warding out his camps. Enigma picking up level 6 so damn quickly there, it just totally took Sick Arrow by surprise, getting caught like that. The very first black hole of the game turns out to be a 3-man black hole. That just simply should not happen. Afterlife failing his first rotation, he tried to go for a kill in the mid lane up against a Viper, but missed the hook shot there. These supports, I honestly don't have a plan for them anymore, because it's obvious the aggro try has failed, but should they be rotating around and maybe babysitting Faceless Void, he doesn't necessarily need it. The Viper certainly doesn't, going one-on-one up against a Venomancer. It's, for him, this is just a farming lane and nothing more. So these supports are really lacking direction. They have no obvious lanes that they should be sitting in, so they continue to sit with the aggro try, but that just simply will continue to fail. Afterlife, it starts going on. Seema the Slayer does not have a hookshot just yet. The teleport in is not going to be in time. And Afterlife does get his first kill. Hookshot or no? Missed the hookshot in the middle lane. Doesn't matter. Gets the kill in the Faceless Void. That's going to be great for him. A huge amount of experience he just picked up. You can see he's going straight for like a lot of early strength. The early power treads helps him out a lot up against the Faceless Void matchup. Disruption Arrow coming out. Scandal whiffing that one as Nubik jukes farther down. And he's able to get himself away. Here comes the first support rotation though. They're going to try and catch out the Venomancer. They get the slow. Thundershock trying to get close enough, slowed down by the wards, but he will eventually get in range of the Viper Strike. The question is, do they really want to go for the dive here? They're going to turn on a PGG, and with a nice Shackle Shot, will ensure the kill. RZ getting low, though. He's going to go down due to the tower. Meanwhile, Afterlife has come in from behind, goes on No Fear, finishes him up, and now going to be able to go into Thundershock as well. Gets a double kill off of that one, and even Nubik is having a hard time. Turns around, power shots up the Venomancer, while also getting out of range of Afterlife. He should be fine from here, and it looks like Afterlife actually turning around here. This is not a good play by him. The Mirana ultimate going out. The invis will be able to save him just in time as Nubik gets himself away. One last right click would have ended the life of Afterlife there, but no surprise though. Dream Team making a lot of early rotations like that.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Ready to respond when Sick Arrow with both the Skywrath Mage as well as the Terrain Protector go into the mid lane. Dream Team has always been a very aggressive team. Just by nature, you can put them on the same pedestal as the old Virtus Pro, Power Rangers, Empire even. I think Empire is the least aggressive CIS team. And yet they're still very, very aggressive going into the mid game. It's just, I think they curb some of their laning phase aggression. And I think that actually paid out bigger dividends than the classic 15-minute go, fight that the CIS scene is known for. Another slow is going to go on to Scandal. And they're going to try and track him down here. The silence is going to go out. They need a Shackle Shot. Unfortunately, there's no obvious target, so instead they go on to Weck. Beautiful Shackle Shot there. But still, good disruption will be able to dodge the power shot. PGG trying to get in close range for that black hole is not going to be getting close enough. Afterlife silenced up to make sure there's no extra pursuit. And Sick Arrow, while they don't get the kill on Mirana, I think they're lucky enough to be alive at this point in time. RZQ, Afterlife, lands the hookshot, it's going to be going for the kill. RZQ has no way to be able to defend himself against this one. Maybe Viper can get a counter kill though, as they start getting up the slows. Wet comes in with the disruption, but Afterlife is still slowed down so much that Thundershock, he's not even going to be able to get in range. He still has brown boots. If he had upgraded boots, there's a chance he could catch up with the Clockwork and get an additional right click in, but as it stands, another missed kill opportunity for Sick Arrow. 7-2, 10.5 minutes in. And here comes Demon Slayer. He's going to go for ZXC. That should be a free pickoff. No rotations are coming in from the Dream Team squad. And even a lucky little bash there at the last second. I think Venomancer was... Oh, never mind. I was going to say Venomancer might have thought about popping the Poison Nova there and attempt to kill Thundershock, but... Between the fact that he only has level 1 Venomous Scale and no levels in his ultimate. Obviously, that was not the thought process
Radiant's
at all.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
I do think this is the correct skill build for the Venomancer, though. Maxing out your Poison Sting. Obviously, the wards is the whole reason they picked up the Venomancer and his ability to lane against the Viper successfully.
You have no right.
But already, they've been put on the defensive here. Sick Arrow looking... I'm not sure why they're trying to force a fight here without a Chronosphere. I mean, I think I harped on this pretty much constantly after the draft and we had that long pause. Faces Void is their key to winning team fights, and if you don't have a Chronosphere, I don't think you should be trying to force it. They do have the mech advantage for about a minute, maybe 2 minutes longer over PGG's Enigma. Who is going to be getting the mech in just another 450 gold. But for the time being, I think
Radiant's
this is why they're 5
man.
They recognize
attack.
They have the mech advantage, and they're going to 5 man accordingly.
Dire's
it's a little
tower
risky without the Chronosphere,
attack.
But if they can maybe get a tower lead over Dream Team by doing this, the problem is they're pushing into Venomancer wards.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
And this is where wards are their absolute strongest. They're super tanky at sitting at 450 health. They have maxed out Poison Sting. So they're actually doing a lot of damage for every hit they hit on a hero. It's just not feasible to be able to take those towers. So instead, Sick Arrow are going to go right back to farming. Mask of Madness is going to be up soon for Seam of the Slayer. This gives Faceless Void solo kill potential. You need that massive upgrade to attack speed for the Faceless Void to be a threat by himself. Before then, his Chronosphere is really just set up for other Pyros. If you get really lucky with your time locks, because you're only going to get 3, maybe 4 hits within one Chronosphere, if you get really lucky with time locks, you might be able to get a solo kill, but it's pretty unlikely. There's the mech, PGG. They may be looking to try and get a gank here on this Faceless Void. Be a good time to do it as well. If they can actually gank him before he picks up level 11. Every ultimate upgrade makes a big difference for the Faceless Void because he becomes more and more active as time goes on. And he picks up his level 2 and level 3 ultimates because then it lowers the cooldown rather dramatically. And especially if you go for an Aghanim's build. I don't anticipate him to be going for an Aghanim's build this time around, though. I think just early damage is his best bet. Mask of Madness into a Maelstrom, turn that into a BKB, then go Mjolnir after that. I think that would probably be the most standard build at this point in time. The Mjolnir is going to have some pretty big benefits, I think, because you have both a Train Protector. If you don't put it on yourself, you have a Train Protector as well as a Viper, who are both pretty tanky frontline heroes who could benefit from having that active static charge on him. So I do believe he should be going for the Mjolnir build this game, but we'll see how he chooses to go for it. Dream Team trying some pushing of their own, but as As difficult as it is pushing into wards, it can be just as difficult pushing into power shot sometimes. Very early, high levels of power shot. It draws the creep aggro off of the tower. It does a good amount of damage and harassment to everybody trying to push. But if they can just get a commitment here, if Shadow Demon can somehow get in range of a disruption and they can get an arrow kill, that'll be a free tower. Arrow comes out, Nubik forced away, and there goes the tower. The attempt at a deny doesn't actually happen.
Tower has fallen.
Top lane, though, they're going to go for Afterlife. Chronosphere laid down. Mask of Madness. Where's the Mask of Madness being popped? Zima doesn't even try for it there. He would have laid down so much more damage if he used the mask, but he didn't even go for it. I'm not sure if he used the Mask of Madness if it would have gotten him the kill. I think it's unlikely just because how tanky the clockwork is. Arrow comes out. Nubik once again sneaking past that one. Black Hole is going to be laid down, though, and Scandal with the Star Storm will be able to finish off Nubik. But that was a Black Hole for one hero kill. Fortunately, though, they will be able to get a lot of damage, potentially even take this tier 2, while at the same time they've taken the tier 1 at the top lane as well.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack. Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Radiant's structures are fortified.
They are, I think that's the best thing you can do at this point in time. If you don't have Chronosphere, don't try and defend your towers. And instead, they're going to trade. It's a 2-for-1. But at the same time, I think it's the best thing you can do in this situation. Ideally, they would have been able to push middle and defend bottom, that bottom tier 2 at the same time. But with Nubik being caught out by the black hole, that just wasn't an option. Taking a look at the net worth, Venomancer is leading the board right now due to the fact he went for a Hand of Midas. He's now picked up a Force Staff to go along with it. Whoa, looks like we had a little bit of lag. No, Afterlife is going to be going for the Yule Scepter, and yes, ZXE did go for the Force Staff. That makes sense up against heroes like the Skywrath Mage and Viper. Positioning is very key against them.
Dire's middle tower.
So that does
attack.
Make a lot of sense. Venomancer is also very useful in offensive position with mobility items. The farther he can push himself into a team fight and get off a good Poison Nova early on, the stronger he is as sort of a just ult and die hero. He's very much a suicide bomber. He's, even as a core, he can be a suicide bomber.
Illusion.
No surprise, Thunderchalk is going to be going for an Aghanim Scepter after he's picked up the mech. The Yule Scepter is pretty curious, though. So Yule Scepter is a really good defense mechanism against the Faces Void and Skywrath Mage, and potentially even the Viper if he dodges the ultimate, the Viper Strike. So if you're fast enough with your Yule Scepter usage, you can defend yourself against the Faces Void ultimate or the Viper ultimate, especially the Skywrath Mage. And I think the Skywrath Mage is really the biggest reason he went for the Yule Scepter here, is because when he jumps on somebody and hook shots and then power cogs, he locks the enemy hero inside of the cogs with him, but he also leaves himself massively exposed to a Skywrath Mage ultimate. I mean, it's the easiest Mystic Flare of your life at that point in time. So now most Clockworks would be going for a Blade Man in order to combat that. But Clockwork is apparently trying to increase his survivability. Instead of trying to trade hit for hit against the Skywrath Mage, he's instead going to be going for the Yule Scepter, which is going to give him the opportunity to put himself in a tornado and dodge all of that potential damage. Seam of the Slayer is going to be going for the Maelstrom right now. We'll see if he deviates from the Maelstrom into a BKB. He may not go for it just because of the fact he may go straight for the damage of the Mjolnir. Because of the fact you have a lot of abilities that will go through the BKB. I would still go for the BKB because of the Venomancer and his ultimate. But I can understand if he doesn't, because he has Black Hole, Purge, as well as Hookshot, which are all going to go through that BKB. PGG, well, there goes the Force Staff and a Disruption, dodging a huge amount of damage there. Power Shot comes out, but the mech will be able to keep him alive. Now Nubik gets in some trouble. ZXE pops his ultimate as he forces back both Thundershock. Afterlife, he's going to start getting aggressive, using that Yule Scepter to set up a kill onto No Fear, but it's going to cost him his life in the process. As Seam of the Slayer comes in, also throws in a good Chronosphere that locks in Weck, but oh, there goes the Black Hole. Beautiful one that's going to catch out too. Thundershock in the back is still going on PGG and will successfully get that kill, but Weck with three stacks of poison, finishes off the Faceless Void. And now if they can get away from this Viper, that will be a damn decent fight for Dream Team. They actually go back in with the Disruption. They're going to go for this kill somehow. Our Zeke, not able to help out the Viper in any way. A couple of stacks, a little bit extra poison. Oh, no, the one charges will keep him alive. They do force the Viper back, though, and that's going to mean a tier one tower going down in the mid lane.
Structures are fortified.
The power of the Venomancer, man.
Dire's middle tower has fallen.
Maxed out. Like, I don't care. Like, I know everyone loves wards, and because you love wards, you also love Poison Sting. But I actually feel that Venomous Gale is massively underrated. So when you get just massively experience boosted, like this Venomancer is, and you're able to get Venomous Gale maxed out by 20 and a half minutes, like being level 14 by 20 minutes is impressive, to say the least. So I think this Venomous Gale is going to make a big impact in a lot of these team fights now, and it gives him much more kill potential with his Poison Nova. If he's able to finish up an Aghanim's in the next 5 minutes, I'm not sure what Sick Arrow can do about that. And I think it also forces Seam of the Slayer to be going for a BKB as his next item. I don't think he can go full Mjolnir damage now. Good amount of survivability on this Venomancer as well because of that. PGG, as we saw in that last team fight, he revealed his most recent pickup, which was that Blink Dagger that allowed him to get the two-man black hole. Shadow Demon, he's going to be grabbing himself a four staff as well, and he's been doing an excellent job with these Shadow Poison stacks. Sick Arrow have not been trying to dodge the poison, the Shadow Poison at all, and they've been, like, it's all reason Seam of the Slayer went down there, is he had three stacks of poison and he didn't successfully backtrack the activation. Whoa! Seema!
Radiant's bottom tower.
Big misplay there.
Under attack.
Seema whiffs a Chronosphere. Murana, I mean, that was quick reaction by Murana leaping away, but still, that should
Radiant's
just not happen. Seema the Slayer.
Has fallen.
Fortunately, it is a level 2 ultimate, so it's going to be back up in just 80 seconds, but missed opportunity that could have ensured them a tier 2 tower here, or at least a trade. We already see ZXE is going to start threatening the base,
Dire's
but
middle tower
Sick Arrow,
attack.
If they'd been able to get off a pickoff, I think they could have forced down
attack.
This tier 2. As it stands, though, I think that Dream
Radiant
Team are either going
are
to
fortified.
Get a better trade out of
Dire's
this, or they're going to
attack.
Force a fight and defend.
I think.
And here comes ZXE, already far forward. He can force staff himself forward. He snagged Nubik there with the slow. Now the hookshot, whoa, whiffing that one. ZXE is also gonna be able to get out the ultimate at the black hole. Four man, but immediately stopped by the silence. Good disruption there from the Shadow Demon and a better Shackle Shot as now Seam of the Slayer comes back in. What you would give for a Chrono right there. No Fear goes down as well. Three heroes out, Thundershock gonna be chased away as well. And only one surviving hero on the side of Sick Arrow. Actually, he's just got a kill on PGG there. That poison is going to be able to ensure him the kill, so. A 2-for-4 exchange. If only that Faceless Void had not whiffed his Chrono earlier. And had either picked off the Murana or still had his Chrono, because that would have been a 5-man Chrono. That was a beautiful black hole, by the way. Well done by PGG. Unfortunately, he just wasn't able to snag the Skywrath Mage, who did a good job with his positioning. When his team started retreating, he made sure he was ahead of the pack and wasn't with the rest of them. And he turned around very quickly and got that silence off. Well done by him, but still. That could have been such an amazing fight for Sick Arrow. And yet, between the lack of Chrono and everything else, no chance for Sick Arrow. 16-7, 24 minutes in, we have over 10,000 gold lead for Dream Team, 12,000 experience as well. And I think we're about to see another pickoff. Our Zeke, sorry, buddy. That counter ward may reveal clockwork, but it's way too late for you. Throws out the Leech Seed as well. Well, he can't actually pop the Leech Seed yet. There goes the ultimate. And he's going to turn on Afterlife here, but if they're not careful, they're going to be caught. Arrow comes in. Oh, it snags our Zeke. Good four staff up the cliff, though. Well done by Nubik. He actually successfully got our Zeke out of what should have been a simple pickoff for Dream Team. You notice Nubik is also beginning to hit pretty hard again. If they get the good Chronosphere, that is going to allow the Focus Fire to come into play. Four and a half seconds of free. Oh, there goes Chronosphere Ultimate. Going on PGG right away. Skywrath Mage over the top with his ultimate. DXC is going to get popped, but not before he gets off his ultimate. And that's going to cost Dick Arrow dearly. They try and fight back. Nubik pops the Windrun, starts going on Weck, but it's not going to be enough damage as he gets bursted down. Now Thundershock is going to get picked off as well as Afterlife lands his hook. Four heroes go down once again. This time only one falls on the side of Dream Team. If they'd been able to pop the Venomancer before the ultimate, it could have been a slightly different fight, but I think Sick Arrow just way too far behind. And now Dream Team, we said they're on a timer, but they are so far ahead at this point. If they can actually secure a mid-Rax, I don't think Sick Arrow can come back. They do still have the late game advantage, but with the way Dream Team are playing and the way I know these guys, and I know they're just not going to give Sick Arrow any room to breathe, I think they're just going to back up and force down a second lane of Rax and Sick Arrow, unless they land just the most massive Chronosphere of this Faceless Void's life. I don't think they have a shot at being able to defend. But they're certainly going to try. I mean, they have the late game advantage, so you're never going to give up off of just a tier 3 going down. In fact, I'm surprised there wasn't enough physical damage from Dream Team to be able to take at least a range Rax there. But suppose they didn't have the Enigma. Speaking of the Enigma, PGG is currently sitting on 3,700 gold right now, and that means we're going to have a BKB for him in just about 30 seconds time, which is going to be awesome. Because then you only have to worry about Chronosphere and Overgrowth. Those are the two abilities that can stop the black hole. Presumably, you won't have to worry about the Chronosphere because you should always be trying to catch Faceless Void in the black hole. So the questionable one is the Tree Protector and how good our Zeke's positioning is. Because the most dangerous thing about this is the Overgrowth. He needs to be close enough to his team that he can respond pretty quickly to popping his Overgrowth and stopping that black hole, but also not hugging them too close that he gets caught in it as well. It's a very tricky game of positioning. And our Zeke throwing down the smiley face as he just popped the smoke within ward range there. Seam of the Slayer. Arrow actually snagged the Windranger in the background, but they're still going to be going for Weck. Oh, nice Yule Scepter usage. There. And the black hole catching him three. Nubik even force stabs himself into it at the same time. Overgrowth goes off. Seam of the Slayer on the background. He's going to fall as he gets burned out of all of his mana. And this is going to be a complete wipe. Arrow lands. Double kill for ZXC, double for Scandal, and there it is. Before Arax even falls, Sick Arrow will call the GG. And Dream Team will move on in the I-League European Qualifier. So very well done by them. Dream Team 168, looking in pretty good form. They've had some slight roster changes. Weck is a newer name that I haven't seen. Scandal and ZXC obviously joining Dream Team for this match. This should be the new Dream Team squad. This should be the new Dream Team squad. I'm not sure if Weck is going to be sticking around. I don't know much information about him, but and I have to say, I think it's looking pretty good. The old Dream Team was a little bit iffy. They were oftentimes too aggressive, but I think with Scandal's his professional touch to it, I think Scandal's a great player. I was really excited about his addition to Power Rangers back in the day, so I think he's going to be a good addition to Dream Team and could give them the experience that maybe the Dream Team was lacking, but we'll have to see how they get on. They're going to be moving into the next round. Next coming up, though, is going to be Just Kings versus TMNT, also known as Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. So that's the next match for the game, for the day, guys. After that, it's going to be Virtus Pro versus Yellow Swag. And then we're going to be doing some custom Dota after the stream has ended. So if you want to stick around for that, not sure if we'll be streaming it or just doing a video. I'll talk to Toby about it. But see you guys in just a couple minutes for more I-League qualifier action.